No, National Poetry Month.
Yes, National Poetry Month, and many other months too. We wanted to have a poetry reading, so we're just going to be sharing any poem that you want to. You are not required to share a poem. If you would like to, we have some books of poetry on the table, and you can pick something. Some people might not have brought poems that they want to share. So, we hold this in the library because we think it's really important for people to be able to share pieces of themselves, their knowledge, their experiences, their artwork. And so we want to provide that space, and we want it to be a comfortable space, a familiar space, a space that you feel happy to come back to. So, if you're interested in learning more about what we have on the schedule this quarter, you can find copies on the reference desk. But other than that, let's jump in. I want to introduce Dr. Valerie Hunt, who will be our facilitator today and be sharing from her original work and guiding us in this process. So, please join me in welcoming Valerie.
So, I want to first give acknowledgement and blessings and honor to the folks whose land we have the honor of being present on, and that is the Duwamish, the Suquamish tribe. This is where this space is here. And so I always want to acknowledge when we're in someone else's home. And for me, homes are homes. And my sister here, Kimberly, asked me to read some of my original work. Yet I think there's really no such thing as original work because we are all of a piece. So I want to read some poems that manifest because I'm on the planet experiencing with other people and other, with people and other ways in which the world is manifesting at the same time. So I want to start with just a little bit of reading from one of my favorite people in the world, and her name is my ancestor, Sister Audre Lorde. She wrote an essay called Poetry is Not a Luxury. Not my writing, but the way we co-manifest together. So can I read a little bit from her? And then I want to hear from you all, and then I will read a poem. That is, as I said, my co-manifesting with the world. The quality of light by which we scrutinize our lives has direct bearing upon the product which we live, and upon the changes which we hope to bring about through those lives. It is within this light that we form those ideas by which we pursue our magic and make it realize. This is poetry as illumination, for it is through poetry that we give name to those ideas which are, until the poem, nameless and formless, about to be birthed, but already felt. So I will recite one of the poems that came to me when our young freedom fighters were in such pain, and I remember the pain in the eyes of my mother and father, who were very young parents. They were 19 years old when I was born. And so this is called Anthem. My blackness inoculates me daily from the false cheerfulness of a lying world. I know that there is a war going on. Me to speak about what is important to me about poetry. I agree with our sister Audre, it is not a luxury. Those of us who write can't stop writing. And those of us who write and want to write, we feel incomplete until there's something in our hands that allows us to write. And poetry allows me to be connected to my deepest self, that is our ancestors, our community, and also for the unbirthed Valerie until I take a pen and write. And I write in longhand. I don't type, I write. I write on any slip of paper I can get my hands on, but I usually like to write on slips of paper. For those of y'all who wear pantyhose, you may know that there's a piece of paper that comes with the pantyhose. When I grew up very poor, so we didn't get to have like fancy paper to draw or do anything on. So my mother would give me these little pieces of pantyhose paper, and I would write on that. So I now write on pantyhose paper. I write on cosmetic boxes. It's the same weight. And when you put a pencil to it, your poetry feels substantial. not all I know, these little slips of paper here. So I write on things. And I found that that Felipe Huerta, who was the poet laureate for 2 years at the for the U.S., for two terms, which means he was a poet laureate for 4 years, he writes occasional poetry. He likes to write them on scraps of paper. So what it means is that poetry is economical. You don't have to have paint. You don't have to have an easel. You don't have to have anything that costs money. You just have to have pen and scraps of paper, or you just memorize. That's why. So to me, that's a liberation. Anyone here would like to share their poetry with us right now?
I just want to say something that you said, Bill, that resonated with me. So I don't write poetry, and I actually find a lot of poetry totally difficult to understand. So I've never been gotten real close to poetry. But I do write, I don't write on an ongoing basis. I've written, when my father died, I wrote a eulogy. And I find that at moments of emotional, either awakening or emotional, whatever, when I'm emotional, that the writing comes, and I write longhand too. I am trying to think exactly what you said. I don't know if it was you find something about the self that you find. Whatever it was that you said, I feel the same way just about writing prose or whatever. Whenever there's a moment when I feel moved, I feel as if I'm getting to the deeper self.
I have a poem I would like to share. It is not my poem. It is the poem of Rudy Francisco, who's a spoken word artist, and you can find him on YouTube. So all of his poems are meant to be heard aloud. And this is from his first book, Helium. So one reason that I really love poetry is because it says things that I'm sometimes scared to say or unable to say in a way that seems comprehensive or important. And I really admire those who are able to convey so much in so little and so few words often. So this poem is called "To the Man Standing on the Corner Holding the Sign That Says God Hates Gays." I've never seen exactly who it is that you paperclip your knees, meld your hands together, and pray to. But I think I know what he looks like. I bet your God's about 5'10". I bet he weighs 185. Probably stands the way a high school diploma does when it's next to a GED. I bet your God has a mullet. I bet he wears flannel shirts and no sleeves, a fanny pack, and says words like, "Get her done." I bet your God watches Fox News, Dog the Bounty Hunter, voted for Donald Trump, and loves Bill O'Reilly. I bet your God is a politician from Arizona. I bet his high school served racism in the cafeteria and offered hate speech as a second language. I bet he has a swastika inside of his throat and racial slurs tattooed on his tongue just to make intolerance more comfortable in his mouth. I bet he has a burning cross as a middle finger and Jim Crow underneath his nails. Your God is a Confederate flag's wet dream. Conceived on a day when the sky decided to slice her own wrists, I bet your God has a drinking problem. I bet he sees the bottom of the shot glass more often than his own children. I bet he pours whiskey on his dreams until they taste like good ideas, probably cusses like an electric guitar with Tourette's plugged into an ocean. I bet he yells like a schizophrenic nail gun, damaging all the things that that care about him enough to get close. I bet there are angels in heaven with black eyes and broken halos who claim they fell down the stairs. I bet your God would have made Eve without a mouth and taught her how to spread her legs like a magazine that she will never, ever be pretty enough to be in. Sooner or later, you will realize that you're praying to your own shadow, that you are standing in front of mirrors and you're worshiping your own reflection. Your God stole my God's identity. So next time you bend your knees, next time you bow your head, I want you to tell your God that my God is looking for him.
Wow.
Your friend is good.
Mm-hmm. Nationally ranked.
Yep.
What we have not done and we should rectify is that we haven't made the circle real in terms of knowing each other's names. May we do that? I'm Valerie.
I'm
Patty.
I'm Rita.
Still Kimberly.
And we have people in this space that we want to acknowledge.
I'm Peggy, and I apologize for not being in the circle, but I am unable to stay the whole time, so I didn't want to interrupt.
I'm Jason, and I'm a media specialist here, and I film these every week, so.
So, anyone else would like to?
Oh, I was going to read from Maya Angelou, who is one of my favorite inspirational. Just, I don't even have the words, the depth of inspiration and connection and wisdom that just emanates from her. Now, this book is called Phenomenal Woman, and it's four poems celebrating women. So I'm just going to read the first one because I'm not familiar with this, but I know that everything she touches is phenomenal. Phenomenal woman. Pretty women wonder where my secret lies. I'm not cute or built to suit a fashion model's size. But when I start to tell them, they think I'm telling lies. I say, it's in the reach of my arms, the span of my hips, the stride of my step, the curl of my lips. I'm a woman, phenomenally. Phenomenal woman, that's me. I walk into a room just as cool as you please. And to a man, the fellows stand or fall down on their knees. Then they swarm around a hive of honeybees. I say, it's the fire in my eyes and the flash of my teeth, the swing in my waist and the joy in my feet. I'm a woman, phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me. Men themselves have wondered what they see in me. They try so much, but they can't touch my inner mystery. When I try to show them, they say they still can't see. I say, if it's in the arch of my back, it's in the arch of my back, the sun of my smile, the ride of my breasts, the grace of my style. I'm a woman, phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me. Now you understand just why my head's not bowed. I don't shout or jump about or have to talk real loud. When you see me passing, it ought to make you proud. I say, it's in the click of my heels, the bend of my hair, the palm of my hand, the need for my care. Because I'm a woman, phenomenal, phenomenal woman, that's me. Oh, I should have read Still Have Nights.
Dang.
My daughter just wrote a poem, Still Have Nights. Anyway, I'm going to do this one more, it's shorter. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still like dust I rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with a woman? Because I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like moons and like suns with the certainty of rides, just like hope springing high, still I rise. Did you want to see me broken? Bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders fallen like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries. Does my haughtiness offend you? Don't you take it awful hard, cause I laugh like I've got gold mines digging in my own backyard. You may shoot me with your words, you may cut me with your eyes, you may kill me with your humanness, but still like air I rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history, shame, out of the husks of history's shame, I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I hear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into the daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. I love this one. Yeah.
Can I make a plug really quickly, like for something? Like Maya Angelou, I taught the Shakespeare class a couple of years ago here, and we one of the questions we dealt with was, who is Shakespeare for? Maya Angelou has one of the best answers, I think. And if you want to find it, just look up Sonnet 29 with Maya Angelou's name and find her. You can find her giving a lecture on Shakespeare. And she does a, do poets do covers? I think they do. She does a cover of Shakespeare's Sonnet 29 that is, it made me cry. I mean, like, it's an amazing, amazing rendition of the sonnet.
Thank you.
Yeah. Just in case anybody wants to check it out.
I love Shakespeare's sonnets.
Yeah.
I didn't know that connection. I'm on that.
Yeah.
After lunch, I'm on that.
Yeah.
May we hear from you?
What's that?
May we hear from you?
Sure.
Since you've cleared your throat.
Can I read an original poem?
Yes, please.
We're reading something in class about, it's called Open Door by Rebecca Solnit, and it's her first essay in a book of hers called A Field Guide to Getting Lost. And one of her ideas is that it's important to get lost because you leave the familiar behind, but then the unfamiliar appears. In a way, that's what this poem's about. It's called Spirits, okay? It's called Spirits. And if you like it, you can find it in City Arts Magazine. Spirits. The widow Lincoln communed with so many spirits, she had to be committed. To be haunted is to be devoted. To paraphrase the secrets of the dead, you need a medium, a mirror in which you look forward to appearances. Alcohol comes from the Arabic word for makeup. Maybe we have to change our looks if we want communion. We have cocktails because we can't stop mixing. We love entertaining possibilities. What we find intoxicating, we could fall for. What we fall for makes us smart. Look at the German shepherd barking at his reflection, the robin that sees in your pain a blue sky for flying free. Socrates feared poetry would make people think their delusions could be true. Wile E. Coyote shared his critical point of view. When he painted the mouth of a tunnel, he thought the roadrunner could not run through. Maybe we are innocent when we fall in love. We lose it when we think we know what's going on. Facades are what we put up with when we feel like hiding. The cover-up is how we live with politicians. The unattractive, honest Abe said he'd wear another face if he had one. The vase our profiles make when we face off must contain our thirst. We have to make out if intoxication's what we want.
Yes. Yes, 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 yes.
Thank you for previewing that. It's going to wait till May.
Thank you all for that.
So this is a poem from Mary Oliver, and I have another poem. I don't know a ton of her work, but have people heard of her before?
Oh, yeah.
She's great. I don't know a ton of her work, but she kind of writes a lot about nature and life and, those kinds of themes. So this is one that my colleague, Kate Victor, just shared with me, while I asked Percy how I should live my life. Love, 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 says Percy, and run as fast as you can along the shining beach or the rubble or the dust. Then go to sleep. Give up your body heat, your breathing heart, then trust.
I love this poem.
That's a good poem.
I have two Percys. I have a dog named Puppy of the United States. It's Pugs. So I dig that. May I read one for one of our colleagues? Her name is Anne Levine. Is it Levine or Levine?
Levine.
Anne Levine is a teacher here, but her sister and her sister, who lives in Portland, is a poet. And Anne's sister, Sherry, said she would allow us to read this poem. So
And Anne couldn't be with us because she has to teach right now. There are two of them, so I'm going to read them both because they're short and they're very, very interesting. See, if you don't wear them, you can't even see. Okay. Grammar lessons. She wrote this on September 3rd. When my students ask me how to use the future tense, I tell them that we use will for a promise or a threat. I will always love you, for example. And to make a plan, we use the present continuous. I am divorcing him. And when they ask about the simple past, he loved me a long time ago. It's not that simple, I tell them. There's certainly nothing perfect about the present perfect. I have loved you since the day I met you. By definition, I ask them, does this mean he stopped loving me? But loving is a non-continuous verb. Loving, I tell them, is incorrect. And for the modals, though confused, I know I still have their interests. I may, I might, I should, I could keep going, but I won't. Instead, I tell them, love is full of tenses. Do you like to read out loud?
No hard words.
No hard words. You want to read it over and then read it? Because then you'll get the feel for this particular book. Yes, we have to tell Sherry that we were jealous and know her poetry. Okay.
This is still from Sherry. Mm-hmm. And it's called Orange Crush. I saw my man put a dollar in the soda machine to buy a Coke, but the Coke didn't come out. Instead, what came out was an orange crush. My man was banging that machine so hard with his fist, yelling, God damn machine! But when he got the orange crush, he drank it anyway. Why, I asked him. Because it's here, and I'm thirsty. You get used to it. You get used to a lot of things, he said. I'll never get used to you losing you, I told him.
So we will thank and Sherry. Do you have anything? Is that some poetry right there? I see.
Oh, this is my note taking.
Oh! Poetry is sort of a note taking. Sister Girl, do you have anything? Would you like to read any more of this? Well, we can read some more. Shall we read some more? Does anybody want to read someone else's poem? I think that, would you like to read someone else's poem?
Sure.
Lucille Clifton, very famous, but she's been lost in history, but one of the more famous black women poets. I think she died, what does it say, 2010, but she was born in 1936.
Won't you celebrate with me, my sweet Clifton? Won't you celebrate with me what I have shaped into a kind of life? I had no model. Born in bed in Babylon, both non-white and women, what did I see to be except myself? I made it up. Here on this bridge between starshine and clay, my one hand holding tight, my other hand, come celebrate. With me that every day, something has tried to kill me.
I saw this poem when I went to a poet's house in Lower Manhattan. And in that house, they have poems, organized by if you're a female poet, if you're a lesbian poet, if you're from a particular tribe. So if you're from the Lakota tribe, there's some Lakota poetry you can just go up and check out. It's just a marvelous space. So and it's free. So if anybody's ever in New York, go over to Poet's House. You want to check it out. So they have a little room for children who can play with different things and make up their own poetry. And so Lucille's face was in the room and also some of her poems.
Are you all tired of my voice yet?
No.
Same author, Lee Francisco. This is called Rifle 2. On average, the Mexican government confiscates approximately 38,000 illegal firearms per year. After the guns are taken, they get dismantled, and the metal is used to make other types of weapons that will be later utilized by their military. In 2012, Pedro Reyes, an artist from Mexico City, convinced his government to donate the guns to him so he could turn them into musical instruments. So somewhere, there's a tambourine, a drum set, a guitar, all made out of things that were used to take people's lives, and now they create a sound that puts life back into people's bodies, which is to say, a weapon will always be a weapon, but we choose how we fight the war. And from this I learned that even our most destructive instruments can still create a melody worth dancing to. And sometimes isn't that also called a battle? I wonder how long it took to convince the first rifle that it could hold a note instead of a bullet, but still fire into a crowd and make everyone move. When I was 6, I was taught how to throw a punch. In the 80s, that was the anti-bullying movement. The first time one of my classmates took a Yo Mama joke a little too far, I remembered all my training. I hit the boy in the face. I turned his nose into a fountain. My fist was 5 pennies. I closed my eyes. I made a wish. I came home with bloody knuckles, and it was the first piece of artwork we hung on the fridge. I remember staring at my hands the same way you stare at a midterm when all your answers are correct. I had no idea what class this was, but I did know I was passing. And isn't that what masculinity has become? A bunch of dudes afraid of their own feelings, terrified of any emotion other than anger, yelling at the shadows on the wall, but still haven't realized that we're the ones standing in front of the light. We learn how to dodge a jab. We learn how to step in before we swing. We learn that the heart is the same size as the fist, but we keep forgetting they don't have the same functions. We keep telling each other to man up when we don't even know what that means. We turn our boys into bayonets, point them in the wrong direction, pull their triggers, and fail to acknowledge all the damage they're doing in the distance. The word repurpose means to take an object and give it amnesia. It means to make something forget what it has been trained to do so you can use it for a better reason. I'm learning that this body is not a shotgun. I'm learning that this body is not a pistol. I'm learning that a man is not defined by what he can destroy. I am learning that a person who only knows how to fight can only communicate in violence, and that shouldn't be anyone's first language. I'm learning that the difference between a garden and a graveyard is only what you choose to put in the ground. One day, I came across a picture of a strange-looking violin. The caption said it was made out of a rifle, and I was like, someday, that can be me.
Mm-hmm. That is why he is nationally. I have one.
He brings the fire.
Yes. I love him. I have one from my daughter, who is 16, and she just did this the other day, and it's spoken word. Some of it is a little exaggerated, but the message is it's 4 minutes and 49 seconds though, so I don't know how y'all feel about that.
Yeah, because it was helpful.
Okay.
Shot an arm, that was how the tears. That was got the beat from pulsing like a beat. When the rain and fog can take it while I'm walking down the street. It's a true shame that this is our society. And people wonder why teens suffer from anxiety. But let me step back and speak on my perspective. Growing up a mixed girl, I was seen as defective. I was too white for the black keys of school, yet too black for the white kids too. From a young age, I was taught self-hate. Called Lion King cause my hair wasn't straight. Couldn't have big dreams around small-minded people. Chose to stay quiet and hide the less they evil. Maintaining a fake smile was tough. I spent many nights wondering why I wasn't enough. I was bullied in school till I lost myself. Till one day in seventh grade I tried to off myself. Took 10 pills more than I was supposed to take. I ran to my sister, tears rolling down my face. I can't imagine what was going through her head when she realized her little sister wanted to be dead. That's when I could tell that I really needed help. Couldn't rely on nobody, so I reached out for myself. Sometimes I look back and regret taking that step. Cause the first thing they did was put me on meds like I was crazy. I swear I was going insane. Couldn't stop all the voices racing in my brain. Telling me to end it all, they were constantly demanding. It's hard to believe sometimes, but I'm still standing, despite the progression of the past. Still standing, to exercise my freedom of expression. Still standing, even when you kick me down. I'm still standing, and I'll always come back around. Still standing, still standing, still standing, even when you kick me down. Still standing, and I'll always come back around. You ever wonder why we tend to blame a victim? Cause I do. Go ahead and take a walk in my shoes. You wouldn't last. I barely got through my own passion. Here I am, still standing with the utmost class. Listen, everybody has a choice until they make it. But sometimes the power in a choice is taken. I found out when I was only 13. Struggling was useless. Then nobody heard me scream, get off. It didn't matter, so I stopped resisting. Let him get what he wants, so it'd be over quicker. I don't know how he did it without any detection. The messed up party didn't bother with protection. Let me give you a minute to let it sink in. I don't need commentary, I know what you're thinking. But I didn't cry or go for help, I didn't want to relive it. So I kept it to myself, no matter how hard I tried, I really couldn't escape. Spent 2 years thinking I deserve to be raped. Bigger picture, that's an issue that is yet to be dealt. Do you know how many girls out there felt what I felt? So afraid and ashamed, so I just let it be. Cause I know in our system he'd end up walking free. You can't silence me, not even if you try. Till I'm 6 feet under, I'ma speak my mind. I'm still standing for the life of me, I don't know how. Still standing, all that matters is I'm here right now. To speak to all the girls that have been bullied into silence. To let you know you're beautiful, don't let them block your shining. Just take it one day at a time. I hope you go and share your story now that you've heard mine. Biggest lesson never learned is don't let them see you sweat. Keep your head up high while you focus on the next. And if you're feeling worthless, just know that you're a dime. And if they ain't stacking up your paper, they ain't worth your time. I wish somebody told me when I was a little girl that I didn't need a man to make me this whole world. And I can never let somebody else determine my worth. Said I will never let nobody else determine my worth. I'm still standing, I'ma say it again. Real life, still standing. Yeah, I'm proud. I'm still standing, despite the progression of depression. Still standing, to exercise my freedom of expression. Still standing, even when you kick me down. I'm still standing, and I'll always come back around. You're still standing, despite the progression of depression. Still standing, to exercise your freedom of expression. Still standing, even when they kick you down. You're still standing, and you always come back around. Yeah. You can.
You want to hear the singing part?
Sure. I'm gonna spread my wings. You can't stop me. I'm gonna spread my wings. Still standing after everything. Still standing. Yeah.
Jack.
Wow.
So, you're going to invite her to come over to our poetry reading,
sure,
right?
Will.
And what day is
how
it?
How do I make this?
The 19th? Is it the 19th, Johnny, do you know?
Yeah.
I think it's the
19th. It is the 19th, yeah. It's in the evening, right?
Yes.
There in Harrison Theater.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
You need to come.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we're trying to soften this. It's really dark. I'm not on my skin.
That's an attitude adjustment. Indeed.
It's interesting because I often, I know this, but I forget it still.
is that so much of the music that we listen to is also poetry.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And so what we traditionally think of as poetry, written prose, is not the only way that poetry exists, right? And being able to not only read something on a page when it might be hard to understand, as you mentioned earlier before, which is why, I'm sorry, I never really connected to Shakespeare, but that was forced upon me in high school. Maybe I'll try reading something again. Sometimes I think loses, to me, lost some of the, a vital piece of what they were trying to communicate, right? That can be heard in the voice, the expression, seen in the body. And so I love spoken word poetry, and I love music, right? Musical poetry, because I get to see that, right? I get to feel that in a way that I don't necessarily get on this page if I don't understand the author's full intentions or where they're coming from. So,
So Young Freedom Fighters, tell us something. You hear, is there any poetry that's in your heart or that you, even if you don't want to recite, is there a poet that you like? Is there something about poetry that you want to share with us so we know what makes you happy? What makes you joyous?
I read poetry, but not in very kind of poetry, so it's not spoken in English. But the thing I like about poetry is that sometimes you can see yourself in the poetry, and it's a life experience of that person. So then when you read it, maybe you can learn things from the poetry too. And I really like spoken poetry because it sounds really nice, the first thing. That's when you want to listen to it. And the second thing is that the message is even more powerful. That's why.
So in what language do you read poetry?
Vietnam.
Oh. I have a poem for you to read then. Can you read in the Vietnamese for us?
Yeah.
One of my friends just sent me a poem that he wants us to put on the wall, and he sent it this morning. May I give it to you to read?
Sure.
Let me see if I can get to it. One of my favorite poems is called Tale of Q. That's my favorite one. I read it every day. It's one of the most famous Vietnamese poems. It's the national poem. Yes. Only now do I see what is here before me, yet from the first my heart could see for sure the days to come. Those are my favorite lines from there. So may I give this to you so you can...
Do you want to read it?
No, it's in Vietnamese.
And I mean
him. Oh. Yes. I would like to. It's a language I want to learn when I have some retirement time. Can I go next? I'm going to pull this up with my phone so I can use it. See, we came to party here. We bring all the party favors. Yes, we do. We'll put on a hot spot. I'll get this up. And Lee would really be delighted. It takes me a moment to put the computer up, all right? My friend Lean and I do piece work together because Thich Nhat Hanh is one of my teachers. Thich Nhat Hanh, who's the Buddhist monk who is in Plum, I got it right.
How you pronounce
it? That's why I gotta learn Vietnamese.
I see.
That's so this is from me. And you can make it bigger if you need to.
So I read 5 minutes.
Yes, and then you're gonna translate for us? Because he just sent this to me. He just sent it to me this morning.
This
No, no, this is not from Tale of Q.
Oh, that's
Tale of Q is my favorite poem from Vietnam. And he sent this to me this morning. Okay.
Did he make it?
I'm not sure. He was going to tell me after y'all figured out how we need to read.
I do. I have class.
Okay.
So
Thank you
very much. This is a wonderful poem.
We'll send you the Vietnamese poem too.
That sounds good. I want to hear it in Vietnamese. I always encourage my students to bring poems from their countries because I like to hear them.
Yes.
It's fun. And then I get them with it. Then you can translate it.
Okay. Yes. Yes. It's more appropriate. It's about love affair. Mm-hmm. So anyone else want to read that? It's in English. Anyone want to try?
I can try.
Yes.
Would you send it to our sister? Okay, Missed Time by Ha Jin. My notebook has remained blank for months, thanks to the light you shower around me. I have no use for my pen, which lies languorously with grief. Nothing is better than to live. A storyless life that needs no writing for meaning when I'm gone. Let others say they lost a happy man, though no one can tell how happy I was.
Hajin wrote a book called Waiting, and if you ever have opportunity to read it, pick it up. It's very beautiful. Not a book of poetry, but a story of a person who waits. A long time for someone. A long, long time. Any other poetry that we might want to hear from folks?
Could read one's a little long though, so we might not have time.
We're open to hearing it. I'm open to hearing it.
Alright. This is a rap song by a rapper named Mos Def.
Mos Def.
That's not mine.
No, you know Mos Def.
It's about hip-hop in general. I'll read it. Speech is my hammer, bang the world into shape, now let it fall. My restlessness is my nemesis, it's hard to really chill and sit still. Committed to page, I write rhymes, sometimes won't finish for days. Scrutinize my literature from the large to the miniature, I mathematically administer. I'm just gonna start rapping it, cause
go ahead.
Subtract the whack, selector, wheel it back, I'm feeling that. From the core to the perimeter, you know the motto, stay fluid even in staccato. Most deaf, full-blooded, full throttle, breathe deep inside the trunk hollow. There's the hum, young man, where you're from, Brooklyn number one, native son speaking in the native tongue, I got my eyes on tomorrow, there it is. While you still try to follow where it is, I'm on the ab where it lives and dies, violently, silently, shine so vibrantly that I squint to catch a glimpse, and embrace the bark with my dark ink fingertips. Used to speak the king's English, but caught a rash on my lips. So now my chat, just like this. Long range from the baseline swish. Move like an apparition. Float to the ground with ammunition. Ch-ch-pow. Move from the gate. Voice cued on your tape, putting food on your plate. Many crews can't relate. Who's choosing your fate? We went from picking cotton, to chain bang line chopping, to bebopping, to hip-hopping. Blues people got the blue chip stock option. Invisible man got the whole world watching. I'm high, low, east, west, all over your map. I'm getting big props with this thing called hip-hop, where you can either get paid or get shot. When your product in stock, the fair weather friends flock. When your chart position drop, then the phone calls. Chill for a minute, let's see who else tops. Snatch yourself spot, don't gas yourself. The industry just a better built cell block. A long way from the shell tops and the bells that L rock. Hip-hop is prosecution evidence and out-of-court settlement, ad space for liquor. Sick without benefits. Luxury tenements choking the skyline, it's how it's low life getting treetop high. Here there's a backwater remedy, bitter intent to memory, a class E felony facing the death penalty. Stimulant and sedative, original repetitive, violently competitive, a school unaccredited. The break beats you get broken with on time and inappropriate. Hip-hop went from selling crack to smoking it. Medicine for loneliness. Remind me of Thelonious and Dizzy. Prop us to B-boys getting busy. The wartime snapshot. The working man's jackpot. A $2 snack box sold beneath the crack spot. Olympic sponsor of the Black Glock. Gold medalist in the back shot. From the sovereign state of the have-nots. Where farmers have trouble with cash crops. It's all city like phase two. Hip-hop will simply amaze you, craze you. Pay you, do whatever you say do, but black, it can't save you.
Curious, and know that next week, as in the beginning, next week we're going to have the co-founder of the Black Farmers Collective coming and talking about urban agriculture and social justice. It should be a fantastic session. It'll be in this room, same time, 12 to 12:50. But before we leave, I want to thank Valerie for facilitating this. Please join me. Thank you, her. And if you have a poet or a poem that you think is, that you want folks to know about, we have a libguide that we create on the library's website. So you can send any poems to me and I can get them up there, links for the words. So, and if you see me and you want to share a poem, feel free to do that in person too. So thank you all for your time and attention.
Thank
you.
May I take a
survey
with you guys?
Yes!
I was going to say survey.
I did too.
Selfie.
Horrible.
Now I understand. I got it.
Okay.
Oh. Oh, oh, I was set. My hand was down. We weren't ready.
Okay.
Yeah.
I
can hear
my
thank you, guys.
Thank you.